This is an auto-narrated audiobook generated by Google. Book, The Right of Way Complete by Gilbert Parker. Introduction. In a book called The House of Harper, published in this year, 1912, there are two letters of mine concerning the right of way, written to Henry M. Alden, editor of Harper's Magazine. To my mind, those letters should never have been published. They were purely personal. They were intended for one man's eyes only, and he was not merely an editor, but a beloved and admired personal friend. Only to him and to W. E. Henley as editors could I ever have emptied out my heart and brain, and, as may be seen by these two letters, one written from London and the other from a place near Southampton, I uncovered all my feelings, my hopes, and my ambitions concerning the right of way. Had I been asked permission to publish them, I should not have granted it. I may wear my heart upon my sleeve for my friend, but not for the universe. The most scathing thing ever said in literature was said by Robert Buchanan on Dante Gabriel Rossetti's verses, "He has wheeled his nuptial bed into the street." Looking at these letters, I have a great shrinking, for they were meant only for the eyes of an aged man for whom I cared enough to let him see behind the curtain. But since they have been printed, and without a by your leave, I will use one or two passages in them to show in what mood, under what pressure of impulse, under what mental and, maybe, spiritual hypnotism it was written. I first planned it as a story of 25,000 words, even as Valmond was planned as a story of 5,000 words, and A Ladder of Swords as a story of 20,000 words, but I had not written three chapters before I saw what the destiny of the tale was to be. I had gone to Quebec to start the thing in the atmosphere where Charlie Steele belonged, and there it was borne in upon me that it must be a three-decker novel, not a novelette. I telegraphed to Harper and Brothers to ask them whether it would suit them just as well if I made it into a long novel. They telegraphed their assent at once, so I went on. At that time, Mr. F. N. Doubleday was a sort of director of Harper's firm. To him I had told the tale in a railway train, and he had carried me off at once to Henry M. Alden, to whom I also told it, with the result that Harper's Magazine was wide open to it. And there in Quebec, soon after my interview with Mr. Alden and Mr. Doubleday, the book was begun. The first of the letters published in the House of Harper, however, was apparently written immediately after my return to London, when the novel was well on its way. Evidently, the first paragraph of the letter was an apology for having suddenly announced the development of the book from a long short story to a long novel, for I used these words. Yet if you really take an interest in the working of the human mind in its relation to the vicissitudes of life, you will appreciate what I am going to tell you, and will recognize that there is only stability in evolution, which the vulgar call chance. Now, sir, prepend. Charlie Steele is going to be a novel of 100,000 words, or 120,000, a real bang-up heartful of a novel. Then there follows the confidence of a friend to a friend. As I look at the words, I am not sorry that I wrote them. They were a part of me. They were the inveterate truth, but I would not willingly have uncovered my inner self to any except the man to whom the words were written. But here is what I wrote. I am a bit of a fool over this book. It catches me at every tender corner of my nature. It has aroused all the old ardent dreams of youth and springtime puissance. I cannot lay it down, and I cannot shorten it, for story, character, soul, and reflection, imagination, observation are dragging me along after them. This novel will make me or break me, prove me human and an artist or an affected literary bore. If you want it, you must take the risk. But my dear Alden, you will be investing in a man's heart, which may be a fortune or a folly. Why, I ought to have seen, and far back in my brain I did see, that the character of Charlie Steele was a type, an idiosyncrasy of modern life, a resultant of forces all round us, and that he would demand space in which to live and tell his story to the world. And behold with what joy I follow him, not only lovingly, but sternly and severely, noting him down as he really is, condoning not, forgiving not, but above all else, understanding him, his willful mystification of the world, his shameless disdain of it, but the old law of interrogation, of sad yet eager inquiry and wonder and non-possumus with him to the end. This letter was evidently written in December 1899, and the other went to Mr. Alden on the 7th of August 1900, therefore 8 or 9 months later. The work had gone well. Week after week, month after month, it had unfolded itself with an almost unpardonable ease. Evidently, the very ease with which the book was written troubled me, because I find that in this letter of the 7th of August 1900 to Mr. Alden, I used these words. A kind of terror has seized me, and instead of sending a dozen more chapters to you, as I propose to do, I am setting to break this love story anew under the stones of my most exacting criticism and troubled regard. I go to bury myself at a solitary little seaside place. It was Mablethorpe in Lincolnshire, there to live alone with Rosalie and Charlie, and if I do not know them hereafter, never ask me to write for Harper's again. This book has been written out of something vital in me. I do not mean the religious part of it. I mean the humanity that becomes one's own and part of one's self by observation, experience, and understanding got from dead years. Anyhow, that shows the spirit in which the book was written, and there must have been something in it that rang true, because not only did it have an enormous sale, and therefore a multitude of readers, but I received hundreds of letters from people who, in one way or another, were deeply interested in the story. The majority of them were inquisitive letters. A great many of them said that the writer had shared in controversy as to what the relations of Charlie and Rosalie were, and asked me to set forever queries and controversies at rest by declaring either that the relations of these two were what in the way of life's stern conventions they ought not to be, or that Rosalie passed unscathed through the fire. I had foreseen all this, though I could not have foreseen the passionately intense interest which my readers would take in the life story of these unhappy yet happy people. I had, however, only one reply. It was that all I had meant to say concerning Charlie and Rosalie had been said in the book, to the last word. All I had meant not to say would not be said after the book was written. I asked them to take exactly the same view of Charlie and Rosalie as they would in real life regarding two human beings with whom they were acquainted, and concerning whom, to their minds, there was sufficient evidence, or not sufficient evidence, to come to a conclusion as to what their relations were. I added that, as in real life, we used our judgment upon such things with a reasonable amount of accuracy, I asked them to apply that judgment to Charlie Steele and Rosalie Evancherel. They and their story were there for eyes to see and read, and when I had ended my manuscript in the year 1900, I had said the last word I ever meant to say as to their history. The controversy therefore continues, for the book still makes its appeal to an ever-increasing congregation of new readers. But another kind of letter came to me, the letter of some man who had just such a struggle as Charlie Steele, or whose father or brother or friend had had such a struggle. Letters came from clergymen who had preached concerning the book, from men who told me in brief their own life problems and tragedies. These letters I prize. Most of them had the real thing in them, the human truth. That the book drew wide attention to the Dominion of Canada, particularly to French Canada, and crystallized something of the life of that dear province, was a deep pleasure to me, and I was glad that I had been able to culminate my efforts to portray the life of the French Canadian as I saw it, by a book which arrested the attention of so comprehensive a public. I have seen many statements as to the original of Charlie Steele, but I have never seen a story which was true. Many people have told me that they had seen the original of Charlie Steele in an American lawyer. They knew he was the original because he himself had said so. The gentleman was mistaken. I have never seen him. As with the purple cow, I never hope to see him. Whoever he is or whatever he is, the original Charlie was an abler and a more striking man. I knew him as a boy, and he died while I was yet a boy, taking with him, save in the memory of a few, a rare and wonderful, if not wholly lovable, personality. For over 20 years I had carried him in my mind, wondering whether and when I should make use of him. Again and again I was tempted, but was never convinced that his time had come, yet through all the years he was gaining strength, securing possession of my mind, and gathering to him, magnet-like, the thousand observations which my experience sent in his direction. In my mind, his life story ended with his death at the Côte d'Orion. For years and years I saw his ending there. Yet it all seemed to me so futile, despite the wonder of his personality, that I could make nothing of him, and though always fascinated by his character, I was held back from exploiting it because of the hopelessness of it all. It led nowhere. It was the quid refert of the philosopher, and I could not bring myself to get any further than an interrogation mark at the end of a life which was all skepticism, mind and matter, and nothing more. There came a day, however, when that all ended, when the doors were flung wide to a new conception of the man and of what he might have become. I was going to America, and I paid an angry and reluctant visit to my London tailor 36 hours before I was to start. A suit of clothes had been sent home, which, after an effective trying on, was a monstrosity. I went straight to my tailor, put on the clothes, and bade him look at them. He was a great tailor. He saw exactly what I saw, and what I saw was bad, and when a tailor will do that, you may be quite sure he is a good and a great man. He said the clothes were as bad as they could be, but he added, "You shall have them before you sail, and they shall be exactly as you want them. I'll have the foreman down." He rang a bell. Presently the door swung open, and in stepped a man with an eyeglass in his eye. There, with a look at once reflective and penetrating, with a figure at once slovenly and alert, was a caricature of Charlie Steele as I had known him, and of all his characteristics. There was such a resemblance as an ugly child in a family may have to his handsome brother. It was Charlie Steele with a twist gone to seed. Looking at him in blank amazement, I burst out, "Good heavens, so you didn't die, Charlie Steele. You became a tailor." All at once, the whole new landscape of my story, as it eventually became, spread out before me. I was justified in waiting all the years. My discontent with the futile end of the tale, as I originally knew it, and saw it, was justified. Charlie Steele, brilliant, enigmatic, and epigrammatic, did not die at the Côte d'Orion, but lived in that far valley by Dalgroth Mountain and became a tailor. So far as I am concerned, he became much more. He was the beginning of a new epoch in my literary life. I had got into subtler methods, reached more intimate understandings, had come to a place where analysis of character had shaken itself free, but certainly not quite free, from a natural yet rather dangerous eloquence. As a play, The Right of Way, skillfully and sympathetically dramatized by Mr. Eugene Presbury, has had a career extending over several years and still continues to make its appearance. End of introduction. Note: it should not be assumed that the Shadir of this story is the real Shadir of Quebec Province. The name is characteristic, and for this reason alone I have used it. I must also apologize to my readers for appearing to disregard a statement made in The Lane That Had No Turning, that tale was the last I should write about French Canada. In explanation, I would say that The Lane That Had No Turning was written after the present book was finished. GF. End of note. They had lived and loved and walked and worked in their own way, and the world went by them. Between them and it, a great gulf was fixed, and they met its every catastrophe with the quid refert of the philosophers. I want to talk with some old lover's ghost, who lived before the god of love was born. There are, it may be, so many kinds of voices in the world, and none of them is without signification. Chapter 1. The Way to the Verdict. Not guilty, Your Honor. 100 atmospheres had seemed pressing down on the fretted people in the crowded courtroom, as the discordant treble of the huge foreman of the jury squeaked over the mass of gaping humanity, which had twitched at skirts, drawn purposeless hands across prickling faces, and kept nervous legs at a gallop. The smothering weights of elastic air lifted suddenly. A great suspiration of relief swept through the place like a breeze, and in a far corner of the gallery a woman laughed outright. The judge looked up reprovingly at the gallery. The clerk of the court angrily called, "Silence!" towards the offending corner, and 700 or 800 eyes raced between three centers of interest: the judge, the prisoner, and the prisoner's counsel. Perhaps more people looked at the prisoner's counsel than at the prisoner, certainly far more than looked at the judge. Never was a verdict more unexpected. If a poll had been taken of the judgment of the population 24 hours before, a great majority would have been found believing that there was no escape for the prisoner who was accused of murdering a wealthy timber merchant. The minority would have based their belief that the prisoner had a chance of escape, not on his possible innocence, not on insufficient evidence, but on a curious faith in the prisoner's lawyer. This minority would not have been composed of the friends of the lawyer alone, but of outside spectators, who, because Charlie Steele had never lost a criminal case, attached to him a certain incapacity for bad luck, and of very young men who looked upon him as the perfect pattern of the person good to see and hard to understand. During the first 2 days of the trial, the case had gone wholly against the prisoner, who had given his name as Joseph Nadeau. Witnesses had heard him quarreling with the murdered man, and the next day the body of the victim had been found by the roadside. The prisoner was a stranger in the lumber camp where the deed was done, and while there had been morose and lived apart, no one knew him, and he refused to tell even his lawyer whence he came, or what his origin, or to bring witnesses from his home to speak for his character. One by one the points had been made against him, with no perceptible effect upon Charlie Steele, who seemed the one cool, undisturbed person in the courtroom. Indifferent as he seemed, seldom speaking to the prisoner, often looking out of the windows to the cool green trees far over on the hill, absorbed and unbusinesslike. Yet judge and jury came to see, before the second day was done, that he had let no essential thing pass, that the questions he asked had either a pregnant aptness, opened up new avenues of deliberation, or were touched with mystery, seemed to have a longer reach than the moment or the hour. Before the end of this second day, however, more attention was upon him than upon the prisoner, and 9/10 of the people in the courtroom could have told how many fine linen handkerchiefs he used during the afternoon, how many times he adjusted his monocle to look at the judge meditatively. Probably no man, for 8 hours a day, ever exasperated and tried a judge, jury, and public, as did this man of 29 years of age, who had been known at college as Beauty Steele, and who was still so spoken of familiarly, or was called as familiarly, Charlie Steele, by people who never had attempted to be familiar with him. The second day of the trial had ended gloomily for the prisoner. The coil of evidence had drawn so close that extrication seemed impossible. That the evidence was circumstantial, that no sign of the crime was upon the prisoner, that he was found sleeping quietly in his bed when he was arrested, that he had not been seen to commit the deed, did not weigh in the minds of the general public. The man's guilt was freely believed. Not even the few who clung to the opinion that Charlie Steele would yet get him off thought that he was innocent. There seemed no flaw in the evidence, once granted its circumstantiality. During the last 2 hours of the sitting, the prisoner had looked at his counsel in despair, for he seemed perfunctorily conducting the case, was occupied in sketching upon the blotting pad before him, looking out of the window, or turning his head occasionally towards a corner where sat a half-dozen well-dressed ladies, and more particularly towards one lady who watched him in a puzzled way, more than once with a look of disappointment. Only at the very close of the sitting did he appear to rouse himself. Then, for a brief 10 minutes, he cross-examined a friend of the murdered merchant, in a fashion which startled the courtroom, for he suddenly brought out the fact that the dead man had once struck a woman in the face in the open street. This fact, sharply stated by the prisoner's counsel, with no explanation and no comment, seemed uselessly intrusive and malicious. His ironical smile merely irritated all concerned. The thin, clean-shaven face of the prisoner grew more pinched and downcast, and he turned almost pleadingly towards the judge. The judge pulled his long side whiskers nervously and looked over his glasses in severe annoyance, then hastily adjourned the sitting and left the bench, while the prisoner saw with dismay his lawyer leave the courtroom with not even a glance towards him. On the morning of the third day, Charlie Steele's face, for the first time, wore an expression which, by a stretch of imagination, might be called anxious. He also took out his monocle frequently, rubbed it with his handkerchief, and screwed it in again, staring straight before him much of the time. But twice he spoke to the prisoner in a low voice, and was hurriedly answered in French, as crude as his own was perfect. When he spoke, which was at rare intervals, his voice was without feeling, concise, insistent, unappealing. It was as though the business before him was wholly alien to him, as though he were held there against his will, but would go on with his task bitterly to the bitter end. The court adjourned for an hour at noon. During this time, Charlie refused to see anyone, but sat alone in his office with a few biscuits and an ominous bottle before him, till the time came for him to go back to the courthouse. Arrived there, he entered by a side door, and was not seen until the court opened once more. For 2 hours and a half, the Crown Attorney mercilessly made out his case against the prisoner. When he sat down, people glanced meaningly at each other, as though the last word had been said, then looked at the prisoner as at one already condemned. Yet Charlie Steele was to reply. He was not now the same man that had conducted the case during the past 2 days and a half. Some great change had passed over him. There was no longer abstraction, indifference, or apparent boredom, or disdain, or distant stare. He was human, intimate and eager, yet concentrated and impelling. He was quietly, unnoticeably drunk. He assured the prisoner with a glance of the eye, with a word scarce above a whisper, as he slowly rose to make his speech for the defense. His first words caused a new feeling in the courtroom. He was a new presence. The personality had a changed significance. At first, the public, the jury, and the judge were curiously attracted, surprised into a fresh interest. The voice had an insinuating quality, but it also had a measured force, a subterranean insistence, a winning tactfulness. Withal, a logical simplicity governed his argument. The flâneur, the poseur, if such he was, no longer appeared. He came close to the juryman, leaned his hands upon the back of a chair, as it were, shut out the public, even the judge, from his circle of interest, and talked in a conversational tone. An air of confidence passed from him to the amazed yet easily captivated jury. The distance between them, so gaping during the last 2 days, closed suddenly up. The tension of the past estrangement, relaxing all at once, surprised the jury into an almost eager friendliness, as on a long voyage a sensitive traveler finds in some exciting accident a natural introduction to an exclusive fellow passenger, whom he discovers as human as he had thought him offensively distant. Charlie began by congratulating the Crown Attorney on his statement of the case. He called it masterly. He said that in its presentations it was irrefutable. As a précis of evidence purely circumstantial, it was useful and interesting. But speech-making aside, and ability, and rhetoric aside, and even personal conviction aside, the case should stand or fall by its total, not its comparative soundness. Since the evidence was purely circumstantial, there must be no flaw in its cable of assumption. It must be logically inviolate within itself. Starting with assumption only, there must be no straying possibilities, no loose ends of certainty, no invading alternatives. Was this so in the case of the man before them? They were faced by a curious situation. So far as the trial was concerned, the prisoner himself was the only person who could tell them who he was, what was his past, and if he committed the crime, what was the motive of it. Out of what spirit, of revenge or hatred, the dead man had been sent to his account. Probably in the whole history of crime, there never was a more peculiar case. Even himself, the prisoner's counsel, was dealing with one whose life was hid from him, previous to the day the murdered man was discovered by the roadside. The prisoner had not sought to prove an alibi. He had done no more than formally plead not guilty. There was no material for defense, save that offered by the prosecution. He had undertaken the defense of the prisoner because it was his duty as a lawyer to see that the law justified itself, that it satisfied every demand of proof to the last atom of certainty, that it met the final possibility of doubt with evidence perfect and inviolate if circumstantial, and uncontradictory if eyewitness, if telltale incident were to furnish basis of proof. Judge, jury, and public riveted their eyes upon Charlie Steele. He had now drawn a little farther away from the jury box. His eye took in the judge as well. Once or twice, he turned, as if appealingly and confidently, to the people in the room. It was terribly hot, The air was sickeningly close. Everyone seemed oppressed. Everyone, save a lady sitting not a score of feet from where the counsel for the prisoner stood. This lady's face.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.